Hello everyone. Till now we have discussed about the Constituent Assembly and the drafting committees and how our constitution came into force. Our constitution came into force on 26 January in the year of 1950. Now today we will see the features of Indian constitutions. So if you see the features of Indian constitution, the first feature I think you know. So the first feature I told you earlier also that Indian constitution is like a book. So book must be written. So it is a written constitution. If you will see Indian constitution, it is like American constitution, it is written constitution. And our constitution is also very lengthy because our founding fathers wanted to cover all aspects of governance, leaving nothing about anything and open to interpretations. And since our country is very large and it is dealing with a diverse cultures, communities, so the constitutions become a very lengthy one. So the second features is lengthiest constitution. So our constitution is written constitutions. And our constitution is the lengthiest constitution of the world. It has 395 articles, 22 parts, and 9 schedules. If you will see, it is detailed document in which the function of the legislature, executive, and judicial organs, both of the center and state relationship, everything is prescribed in a very elaborate manner. If you see in Indian constitution, for each and every crime, what will be the punishment? Everything is mentioned. There is a no scope for you can flee away from that. Everything is mentioned in our constitution. For that, it is the lengthiest constitutions, because our founding fathers, he never wanted that there should be any confusion. So he did not want to make any confusion among Indian citizens. So he wrote everything, or his committee wrote everything, whatever it was possible on that time. For each and everything, it was prescribed what it's about the center-state relationship. If you will see among the state-to-state relationship, if you see the role of the governor, role of the president, role of the prime minister, everything is mentioned in our constitution. So the third thing, if you will see, that it is the assimilation in nature, means assimilation of features. This is our third features, that this is a assimilation of features. If you see Indian constitution, our founding father, who believed that we should take whatever the things is good. Our father is also telling us sometimes that you will take anything. If anybody is having any good thing, you will just take the good things, and whatever the bad thing is there, you just leave it onto them only. So our founding fathers is also doing the same thing. He had taken all the good characteristics or features whatever the other countries had on that time or had in their constitutions. If you see from the British constitutions, we had taken parliamentary form of government, rule of law, lawmaking procedures, single citizenship, institution of speaker, doctrine of presbyter of civil servants. And from American constitution, we had borrowed judicial system, fundamental rights. And from Canadian constitutions, we had borrowed federal systems with strong central authority, residual powers, center-state relation. And from Irish constitutions, we had taken directive principles, election of the president. And from Australian constitutions, we had taken concurrent list, freedom of trade and services within the country. And from Venner constitutions, we have taken emergency provisions. And the Government of India Act, which was passed in the year of 1935. Hopefully you have learned about it, and if you have not learned about it, surely you will learn about it in details after few chapters. So in Government of India Act, there were lots of features, and from that features we have taken at least more than 50%. So from that Government of India Act, we had taken office of the governor, powers of the federal jury, everything. And from South African Constitution, we had borrowed amendment of the constitutions. Clear? So these are the features. Here you can see these are the features. These are the features we had borrowed from different countries. Clear? So there are three features: written constitution. Indian constitution is a written constitution. Indian constitution is the lengthiest constitution of the world, and it is an assimilation of features. Clear? Now the first thing you can see, the preamble of the constitution. So the first thing you have to understand, that what is preamble. So preamble is the first page. If you see in your book also, then you can see the first page, which is called preface. So what is preface? Preface is the summary of your total book or whole book. So as like our constitution, it is so lengthy, it's not possible for any person to read each and every line or to go through by each and every pages. So the preamble is the mirror image of our constitution. So if you will see the preamble of the constitutions, you have a basic idea about that what our constitution is based upon. So if you will see the first word, so the first word is we. So it is a very beautiful word. Here it not represent I or you, it represents you, we. We means we all together. Means here it represents that though we are divided through our culture, through our religion, but still we are united because we are the people of India. So it represent us. It not represents you or I. It represents everyone in this country. So it represents that we, the people of India, solemnly resolve to constitute India into a sovereign, socialist, secular, democratic republic. So it shows the objective of Indian constitutions. If you see these five words, so these five words are not just words. These are the basic objectives of our constitutions. India is a sovereign country. India is a socialist country. India is a secular country. India is a democratic country. And India is a republic country. We will get to know each and every term in details afterwards, but let's see the preamble at first. So it shows that the we, the people of India, resolved or to constitute India as this five features or five objectives. And it also guaranteed to all citizens, it says that to secure all citizens justice, liberty, equality, and fraternity. If you will see, these are the basic ideals of any country. For these are the basic rights which should be given to each and every citizens of any country, because these are the basic rights. This, without these basic rights, it's never be possible for any person, it's not possible for anyone to live in this world. Because we need justice, we need liberty, we need equality, and we need fraternity for our development. So it guaranteed us, it secured our these four rights, and which is prescribed in the preamble. So our constitution maker, they wanted to show us the mirror image of the constitution. For that they were written the preamble of India. And it is a beautiful preamble. If you see, that here it is mentioned each and everything, or if you see the preamble, then you can see everything about or each and every features of Indian constitutions which were written in the Indian constitutions. Clear? So the first thing, if you will see, if we will come, so hopefully it is clear to you that what is the preamble of the constitution. Preamble of the constitution is the summary of the constitution, and it is the first page of our constitution. If you will see, constitution is like a book. So in book there is a first page which is called preface, which shows the summary of the book. Like the book, if our constitution is a law book, then the first page is called preamble, and preamble is the summary or the gist of our constitution. Is it clear? So if you will see the objectives of the Indian constitutions, so the first objectives we had seen, or we have seen now only, sovereign. So what is the meaning of the word sovereign? So if you see the word sovereign, which means that India is an independent country. So the word sovereign says that India is an independent with the ability to take responsibility for all decisions. So it is an independent country, it is free from any other countries, and it has the ability to take responsibilities for all the decisions that the country makes. So India is internally and externally sovereign. It's not internally, means it's not about the decisions about in internal matter as well as the external matter also. It takes decision, it could take decision, and it is sovereign, means which is externally free and internally also free, and free from control of any foreign power or foreign countries. And it has a government which is directly elected by the people and make laws that govern the people. So hopefully it is clear to you that what is the meaning of the word sovereign. Sovereign means free from any other or any foreign powers. So we are now independent and we are free from any foreign powers. Clear? Now the next objective, if you will see, socialist. So what is the meaning of socialist? If you see the word socialist, it was added in the preamble before words, the word socialist. It was not there, socialist and secular. These two words were not there. It was added in the year of 1976. So it implies social and economic equality. Social equality means the absence of discrimination. So why India is called a socialist country? Because it guarantees the social and economic equality. What do you mean by social equality? Social equality means in our society there should not be any discrimination. And economic equality means, if you see, then we should not have any discrimination on the ground of economical ground. Means we should have equal payment, whether we are belong from any other religion or any other caste or anything, means equality, economic equality. And there are another kind of equality, economic equality, which means that government ensure us that we should get equal salary, you can say. That is economic equality. But in India it is not practiced, because we are not getting same salary. If you will see, Ambani is getting something and we are getting something. So in India, economic equality is guaranteed, but it is not in full term, if you will see. Clear? And if you will see that it implies that the government of India takes upon itself the responsibility to see that there is a more equitable distribution of the national wealth. It is also the objective of the government to ensure that all citizens, particularly the economical weaker sections of society, are provided with state protection and care. and free from exploitative forces. Like in corona times also, if you'll see that governments, if you'll see that various governments, state government and central government, they are also helping the poor people or weaker section. Clear? So it is also kind of a economic equality. The next one is secular, if you see. So what do you mean the word secular? So secular, if you see, it was integrated in the 42nd Amendment Act in 1976, as we had discussed earlier. And it implies, if you see, it implies equality of all religion and religious tolerance. India does not have any official state religion. India is not a Hindu state, India is not a Buddhist state, India is not a Muslim state. So the any religions in the eyes of the government, each and every religion is equal. So the government should not be, all religions are equal in the eyes of the government. And the government should not favor or discriminate against any religion. All the citizens, irrespective of their religious beliefs, are equal in the eyes of the laws, and all religions should be treated with equal respect. So this is called secularism. Now next one is democratic. So democratic means, hopefully you know the term democracy. So democracy means government of the people, for the people and by the people. Means government is selected by the people who are having 18 years of age or through the adult franchises. What is universal adult franchises? That government is selected by people, and who are called adult franchises means who is 18 years of age or above 18 years of age, they are called adult franchises, universal adult franchises. So they are through universal adult franchises, we, the people of India, selected our government, and government not rule us, they give the directions and they are taking decisions on the behalf of us. Clear? So this is called democracy or democratic country. The next one, if you will see, republic. What do you mean by the republic? There are two types of government. The first one is republic, second one is monarchical. So if you will know monarchical, then you can get to know easily about the republic. So republic, monarchical means that whoever the highest authority, means the king, if the son of the king become the king. So in India, if you see, our now our prime minister is Modi. So if Modi's son become again prime minister, then it is called monarchical type of government. But now we have Republic, now India is a republic state. So means that head of the state is elected directly or indirectly, because we have democracy. So it is not based on the hereditary basis. So we are selected, or the, what do you mean the term, or what do you mean by the word republic? So republic means the head of the state, they should be elected directly or indirectly for a fixed tenure, means for 5 years. In India, it is for 5 years. So the president of India also, if you see, it is elected by an electoral college for a term of 5 years, and the post of the president of India is also not based on the hereditary, means the president's son is not become the president. Clear? So it is called republic. Now if you will see, so hopefully this is clear to you, what are the objectives of the constitution. So if you will know about the preamble or this five term, so these five terms are the actual objectives of the Indian constitution, as I had told you earlier also, that our preamble, if you know our preamble, then you know our constitution. Now next one is ideals of the preamble. So ideals of the preamble, if you will see, so again, if you will see this four term, then you can say that what are the ideals. First one is justice. So justice does not restrict itself to only legal aspects, but it is used in a wider context of fairness and equality, where all are given equal opportunities to live their lives with dignity. Correct? So, justice means that equal opportunity to live their lives with dignity. Clear? And there should not be no one fears to aspire for higher social positions or express himself. The second one is liberty. So, the term liberty emphasizes that every citizen has the freedom. Freedom, because freedom is the, there was a strong thriving for freedom. For that only we got independence. So, this is the basic ideal of the preamble. If you see liberty, so it gives us the freedom of thought, expression, faith and worship. If you will see the preamble, then you can get to know in better way. So, if you see liberty, then liberty of thought, expressions, belief, faith and worship. So, we have liberty of thought, expression, belief, faith and worship. And if you see equality, then we have in the eyes of the law, all citizens irrespective of their caste, creed or gender. We have equality of status and opportunities and to promote among them all. Means equality are promoting among all of us. And fraternity means the feeling of brotherhood. So, here the fraternity which assuring the dignity of the individual and the unity and integrity of the nations. Clear? So, this is called fraternity. Means the spirit of brotherhood, you can say. So, here these are the four ideals of the preamble. So, hopefully today's class is also clear to you. We had discussed about the ideals. There were four ideals. We have seen justice, liberty, then equality and fraternity. Clear? Fraternity. Clear? Now, today we had discussed about the features of Indian Constitution. Then we had seen the preamble also. Then we have seen the objectives of our Constitution. Then we have seen the ideals of the preamble also. Correct? So, this is the end of your chapter. Thank you.